Thanks very much. Hello everyone. How are we doing? Are you alright?
Very good.
Yeah, so I'm going to be talking to you about a form of testing today called visual regression testing. Has anyone heard of it? Any hands in the air? Oh, we've got a few nods. Here we go. Fantastic. So just first a little bit about me. Who's this guy? Hello, I'm Sam. As I mentioned before, I'm a developer. I work at Sky in Leeds. I've worked for about a year and a half now. I've been down to their main campus in Now TV and Osterley and all sorts of stuff. So I've been around the block a fair amount. What do I enjoy? Running, outreach and tech, all three feature pretty heavily tonight, so I hope you enjoy. What I don't enjoy, CSS bugs and actual bugs. I'm terrified of wasps, so. Moving on, I thought we'd start with a game, spot the difference. So what I want you guys to do is you can see two images on the left and right. I want you to tell me how they differ. So hands straight in the air. They're really difficult even from the start. So here we go, round one. Are you ready? I'm going to take that as a yes. That's right, left and right, what's different? There we go.
Lace up a different colour.
That's right, it's hot pink on the right. So there we go. There's no prize, I'm afraid. Life's not fair, sorry. Okay, so round two. This one's a little bit harder. Hand straight in the air when you can see it.
The gap's different.
Oh. There we go. I did say hands up, Naomi, but that's fine. Don't worry. The gaps are different. So what we've got on the right, so for any CSS whizzes out there, we've got a padding of 10 pixels on the right, whereas we've got 20 on the left. So slightly more difficult. It tricks your eyes at first. You think the pictures are smaller, but they're not. So there you go. Round three. All right, here we go. Hands straight up in the air. There we go, what are we saying?
Is the text bigger on the left one?
No, you are wrong.
Is it maybe the bar underneath the title text is, has more padding? It's pushing the, it's pushing the text boys.
I don't think so.
There's no difference.
Ah, you're wrong. That would be a good trick. Let's just say the residents of Paris are going to be pretty upset. Okay, lots more. How are we doing?
Is the image bigger?
No, it's not. It's not.
Oh, it's the text of the Paris Marathon.
That's it, it's slightly cut off. Yeah, so someone's put a fixed height on that div and it's obviously cut that off. So what point am I trying to make here? Well, amazingly, this fits in so well to Tom's talk, it's unreal. So what I'm talking about tonight is cases whereby you've changed a small piece of your application and actually what's happened is that you've not taken into account that it's changed something completely different somewhere else in the app. Say you've updated your global, say, margin on the left, and it's balked the rest of the site. And your tester, you said, hey, don't worry, I've just changed the home page. And they go, and the login's all messed up, and you get a call from your PO, you know, at midnight, 2 days down the line, and they're saying it's all broken, and you think, well, I didn't change it. You did. And the idea is that you can't test every single page every time you make a CSS change. It's just not possible. So what do? We do what we do for everything else in the tech industry, and we automate it. So I'm talking about a form of testing called automated visual regression. And to give you an idea of what that is, kind of there's lots and lots of different libraries out there, but they all follow the same sort of magic formula. So the first thing you do is you point your application to some mock data. You put it in a state. So state, I'm not using that in the term that the React wizards out there know. What I mean there is anything from loading the application as it is, to hovering over an element, to clicking on something. So anything you do to the page to make a change places it into a different state. And we use tools such as Puppeteer and Selenium in order to do that. You take a snapshot of that page. You compare that snapshot to a reference. And if your snapshot matches, then hooray, you've passed the test. And if it doesn't, it's normally because of one of two scenarios. The first is that you've made a change on purpose and you want to update your reference to reflect the fact you've changed the CSS. And the second is, oh no, you've broken the site and your test fails and tells you, you idiot, go back and fix that so that you don't get that call at 2 o'clock in the morning. So you up, you rerun it after that and it will succeed, hopefully. So today I'm going to be talking about a particular library. It's called BackstopJS. So this is a library which is written in Node. So what happens is that you write scenarios in JSON, which points your browser to a certain application, and you write some properties to put it into a certain state. Then what you do is you run Puppeteer and Chrome scripts in order to either click on elements or type something and see if an error message occurs, so placing your application into that state. You then run your scenarios, you take snapshots in headless Chrome, and then using the HTML5 Canvas API and ResembleJS under the hood, it's absolutely magic. What it does is it compares two images and it says, right, pixel by pixel, you have X number which are different. And once it passes the threshold, it says, right, your test has failed, these two images are different. And then what happens is it outputs it to a really, really nice React report, which you can use a slider to see exactly where on the page it's changed. Cool, so this is kind of the most basic test you're ever going to see. You can see there's four properties in this JSON scenario. We've got a label, so we're saying that this is the BackstopJS homepage. We're saying that there's a URL, so localhost 3000. There's a mismatch threshold. Now what this means is the percentage of pixels on the page that need to change in order for your app to fail. So this is completely alterable. You can change it to as little or as high as you want. And what that means is that you can make it really sensitive, or you can say that, well, we don't really care. Only if you move an image right across to the other side of the page do we actually care about what you're doing here. Cool, so I'm going to break the cardinal rule and try and do a live demo, which never works, so bear with me. Cool, so this is a little site I've made. It's called Lace Up. It's not really anything, really. The search bar doesn't work. You know, it's crap, really. But it does prove my point. So we've got several different application states here. So the first is just as it sits. There's nothing really going on. The second is if I hover over this or any of these tiles, they enlarge slightly. There's a little animation. And the third is that if I click on any, this little modal appears and it blanks out the rest of the page. Cool, and we're going to test some of this using BackstopJS. Cool, so the first time I run this application, what I want to do is just test that really basic scenario. So if I run here BackstopTest, you can see it's going to execute that. It always failed. Ooh. Don't worry, I meant for that to happen, it's all right. What's happened here is that we don't actually have a reference to compare against because it's the first time we've run it. So what we're going to do actually is just to go back to that command line, and instead of running BackstopTest, what we're going to say is I want you to whitelist that image you just saw. So use that test image that you've just created as the reference. So if I put BackstopApprove here instead, what you should be able to see is that this has just popped up in this reference folder, which is a snapshot of the app that we just took. Now what I'm going to do again is I'm going to run that test command. So we're going to run Backstop again and say compare the application as it stands to this snapshot. And as you might expect, it's passed. So there we go. You can see that there's no difference between our application and the reference image. However, if I go in now and I go and change a property in this CSS, so say this banner text at the top, I change that to be gray. I've just spelled gray. Now I run that again. No, that wasn't meant to happen. Let's do something a little bit drastic. Okay. There we go, that's a bit better. So I put 400 pixel padding on this top here. And what you can see is that, yeah, it's pushed everything straight off. You can see that there's a visual regression between the test and the reference image. So there we go. You can see that it's completely changed, and it tells you. And not only that, but if we try that again and we click this diff icon here, you can see it's that hot pink returning again. It shows you exactly on the page where you've got that regression. Now the idea would be that you run all the happy paths of your application. Whenever you run this through your pipeline, you run these visual regressions. Now that means that for any territory, for any application, for any iteration of the code you release, you're testing that it looks as it should. So that's the premise behind it. So I'm just going to go through a few more kind of in-depth scenarios now. So that's the most basic usage that we can do there. Now we do development in 2020, which means that we're obsessed with mobile first. We want our applications to be pixel perfect in the smallest devices up to your ultra 4K, 8K, $1 million, whatever screens, right? So the other thing you can do in Backstop is you can define a viewports property. And this says, okay, run Backstop against different viewports, so different resolutions of screen, to see what it looks like. So you can run the same test several times to see what the effects are. So Blue Peter style is what I made earlier. We've got the reference being run three times at different dimensions, and then the passing tests on the left and right. So another thing that you can do in sites these days, I mean, who's ever dealt with trying to get asynchronous data back from the server? Who's ever dealt with that? Yeah, brilliant. So the thing is that if we ran Backstop right now, but we were trying to load data from the server, we don't know whether that data is actually loaded or not. So to kind of give you an idea of this, what I'm going to do is get rid of that horrible padding because it looks awful. I'm going to load this where it's trying to load some data from the back end, right? So about a 4 second animation there, and then it loads the data in. So what it does, if we tried that original scenario, is it would fail because it would try and capture the loader as opposed to the resolved data in the reference. So what we're doing in this case instead is we're going to say, okay, wait 3 seconds and then capture the data. So to show you what that looks like, you can see the first one here has failed. It said the reference is this, so the data loaded in, but the test I've seen is loader, so we haven't waited long enough for that data to resolve. But the second one, where we've waited 3 seconds, that data has actually loaded in. Now, I know what some of you are thinking, yeah, okay, but how do we know that data is actually going to load in 3 seconds? Well, the truth is we don't. Sometimes it takes longer. If you've got a bad network, then it can take up to 10 seconds in really bad days for your data to actually come back. So another thing that we can do is instead of waiting for a defined amount of time, we can say, wait for an item to appear on a page before we actually take a screenshot. So in this case, we're saying wait for any of those race tiles to actually be rendered in order for this to actually, for a screenshot to be taken. So I've got another scenario here. And in this one, what we're doing is we're waiting for no time at all. And you can see you just get this loading icon. You can say, okay, wait for 1 to 2 seconds, you still get this loading icon, the data hasn't resolved, so that's actually got a delay on it. And then what we said in the last one is this is truly asynchronous, we're waiting for that data to come back before we actually take that screenshot. And that's what we've done here, so that's how we get rid of asynchronous behavior in BackstopJS. The other thing you can do, I'm trying to go back to the screenshot, here we go, is instead of waiting for a selector to appear on the page, can actually wait for a console lock to be locked to the console. So in this case, I've just said, all right, wait for the content to be loaded before you take the screenshot. Now this is useful, for example, if one of those race tiles, I don't know why they would be, were spinning around or we couldn't predict the behavior it was actually going to look like. We want to take an example of something that's non-visual before a snapshot's taken, and that's quite a good way to do it. So earlier I talked about placing an application in a state, so what happens when I hover over an element. And we saw before that when we hover over one of those race tiles, they enlarge like so. Now, we want to capture that pseudo selector in our test as well. We want to make sure that when we're going through our application, we've not broken any of those hover effects. So we can do that by saying, all right, wait for this selector to be hovered over. And so your browser tool will go and hover over that icon, making it enlarge before a screenshot's taken. We've also got this property of post-interaction wait, and what that does is waits 2 seconds for the transition to resolve, for that animation to occur before it actually takes the screenshot. Now, what does this look like when we see it in code? Here we go. So the top one here is without that hover selector added, so we can see that it passes because we said, yeah, don't hover over anything, just compare it to the reference. And in the second one, you can see that if we have a look between the reference and the test, this one's hovered over, and this test is failing because we can see that there's a diff between the reference and the selector that's hovered over. So there we go. We can assert that there's a difference between the reference image and pseudo selectors in the application. And last but very much not least, can I click it? Yes, you can. Apologies. Very, very similar to the last one. What we're doing here is instead of hovering over it, we're going to click one of those tiles to make sure the modal renders. So just to show you that in the application, you can see that that's now appearing here using some style components under the hood I've got to run. So we want to have a look at what that looks like when we take a visual regression of it. So when we run Backstop against that, you can see, find it, that when we don't add that selector, it matches the reference and it passes. Whereas when I hover, when I click that icon, you can see that there's this difference between the test and the reference, making the pipeline fail, telling you to, okay, update your test and make sure that that's passing. Right, so yeah, I just want to talk about a few other little things, really. I don't really have time to go through every single property in the readme of Backstop.js, but one other thing you can do is the on before and on ready properties. So this allows you to do more advanced kind of situations. Say that you had a login page, you wanted to test that I put in a username, pressed enter, and I get an error message. This is a perfect candidate for that. So if anyone's not used Puppeteer before, it's a library that allows you to interact with the Chrome APIs, so it allows you to navigate to pages, click on things, type things in. So yeah, it's really useful. The other thing you can do, as I've mentioned, is make the application more sensitive. So say I want to decrease or increase the threshold for this test to fail. The other thing is debug mode. This is really useful. So what you can actually do, instead of running this headlessly, you can actually spin up the browser that you're testing against and watch the application go through the steps. So watch it click on that icon, watch it type in that text before it takes the screenshot. That way you can see exactly the state that the application's been put on and the steps it's followed prior to actually taking the snapshot. And the final thing is you can hide selectors. So as I've mentioned before, we want to run this against mocked data, but there are certain things that you can't mock, such as transitions. There are things like clocks, so if that's plugged into your system, it's always going to be different every time you run this test. So you want to hide those selectors to make sure they're not captured in the visual regression. So even if they're different, they pass. Bonus round. Right, okay. Still no prize, I'm sorry. So yeah, this one's really difficult. Let's try and beat Backstop. Cut this to 30 seconds because it is very difficult.
Those three lines grey and your legs up. And that just
my... They're the same colour, I'm really sorry. Really sorry. I wish I could give it to you.
Is the sky more blue on the one on the right?
We're grasping at straws.
Images have bigger borders.
No, it doesn't. I'm really sorry. Really sorry.
Is that top image bigger than the
other? You know what? I'm making my doubt myself, but I don't think it is. Really sorry. So it's really, really, really small. And this is just to demonstrate the sensitivity of this library. You can see that on this tile, this icon has 1 pixel more padding between the mountain and the three. I have to say, guys, I'm disappointed. But there you go. So that's just to show you how sensitive you can actually make this this library. Cool. Just a couple of gotchas before I finish off. If you're thinking about putting this into a pipeline, you've got to remember to be persistent. So the nature of visual regression tests is that they are very visual, and you want to keep those. That's not really obvious. You want to keep these resources so that you can refer back to that pipeline build. So some things like Circle CI, they have inbuilt persistence, but then other technologies you might want to have a look at using an Amazon S3 bucket to store these so that you can go back and refer to them. The other one, as I've said, is mock data. If you're changing the data every single time you run these applications, of course you're going to get a visual regression. So you want to make sure that this is a perfect candidate for running on like a staging site prior to you push into production after you've done your functional unit and integration tests. And the other one, well, it works on my machine. I must hear this twice a week. But what this is quite easily mitigated in the case of Backstop.js, where you've got different types of different versions of Backstop, different versions of Node. You can kind of eliminate a lot of that, those teething pains, by containerizing the tests, containerizing your application so that everyone's seeing from the same imagery, especially on CI. Cool. So I think that's it. I've got a few QR codes, so I'm going to leave this slide on the board. There's my LinkedIn on the right, and also the GitHub for this repo on the left, if anyone wants that. That's me. Thank you very much. Are there any questions?